This is the sacral plexus, the network of interwoven nerves that branches out from your sacrum and some of your low back. Together, they communicate nervous information to structures on the back of the leg and lower leg, the foot, and some of the pelvic muscles. If you've heard of the sciatic nerve before, it starts as a branch of this plexus. In this video, we'll look at how this thing is organized and where those nerves end up going. Hello and welcome. If you're new here, my name is Patrick, and this channel is all about anatomy and physiology. The sacral plexus is one of the major nerve plexuses in the body, along with the brachial, cervical, and lumbar plexuses. I've got a video for each one of them in a playlist if you want to learn those too. Plexus comes from the Latin for braid, so you can think of these structures like braids, or webs of nerves that merge together and split apart before heading off to their final destinations. But we need to be more precise, because it's only a piece of the nerve called the anterior ramus that contributes to the plexus. When I say anterior ramus, or rami in the plural, I'm pointing to a split at the spinal root, the spinal root being the portion that pokes out from between each vertebrae. Each spinal root typically has a smaller posterior ramus that pokes backwards into the skin and muscles around the spine, while the bigger anterior ramus goes out into the plexus and becomes the bigger peripheral nerve. Okay, so which spinal roots are we looking at? Well, the sacral plexus gets innervated by the sacral spinal nerves, S1, S2, S3, and S4. But it also shares input with the lumbar plexus via the anterior rami of lumbar spinal roots L4 and L5. But heads up, the spinal roots of the sacral plexus look a little different than the other plexuses. The other plexus's spinal roots poke out between intervertebral foramina, which are gaps between pairs of vertebrae. But since the sacrum itself is one fused bony structure, the rami poke out through the sacral foramina, which is the anatomically correct term for holes in the sacrum. The foramina and spinal nerves are labeled S1, S2, S3, and S4. Nice and simple. There is a pair of fifth sacral nerves and a pair of coccygeal nerves, but those exit out of the sacral hiatus and become their own little coccygeal plexus. Now, up until this point, you could picture the spinal cord like a thick rope of nervous tissue running through the vertebral column. But around the level of lumbar vertebrae 1 and 2, the spinal cord tapers off into the conus medullaris, or medullary cone. From there, all of those spinal nerves together are called the cauda equina, which literally translates to horse's tail. Most of these green spinal nerves make up the bulk of the lumbar plexus, while these blue ones contribute to the sacral plexus, innervating the lower limb. Before we go any further with neuroanatomy, we need a quick primer on the bony and muscular anatomy, especially since the sacrum is different from the other vertebrae. The sacrum attaches to the rest of the pelvic girdle via the sacroiliac joint, or SI joint. The iliac part of that joint is the ilium, the wide bone that creates the bowl shape of the pelvis. The rest of the girdle is made by the pubic bone anteriorly and the ischium inferiorly and posteriorly. And while we could fill a video with all the foramina and tuberosities of the pelvis, the one I need to point out is the sciatic foramen, both the greater foramen superiorly and the lesser foramen inferiorly, which we can see in this posterior view of the pelvis. Like I mentioned earlier, foramen just means a hole, and the sciatic foramina are holes that allow things to pass from inside the pelvis to outside the pelvis, like the sciatic nerve that is named after. But there's a muscle that gets in the way of that opening called the piriformis. This guy originates on the sacrum and inserts on the femur, and separates the greater and lesser sciatic foramen from each other. This muscle will act like a reference point throughout today's lesson. We'll see a bunch of structures either dipping over or under the piriformis to get to their destinations on the lower limb. So now if we look at the whole sacral plexus, you'll notice it takes this upside down L shape, branching laterally from the spinal cord before descending down the leg. That helps it work with the leg's anatomy, but also to innervate different structures from the lumbar plexus, which handled most of the anterior and medial lower limb. If you haven't seen the lumbar plexus video yet, I'll link it up here, but at the end of that video, I mentioned that spinal root L4 merges with spinal root L5 to become something called the lumbosacral trunk, a merger of the lumbar and sacral plexuses. Sometimes you'll have to learn each plexus separately, while some professors teach them together as the lumbosacral plexus, which would look like this and is overwhelming to say the least. This video is long enough as it is, so I'm separating them into two videos. But all that said, we can finally get into the nerves of the sacral plexus. Let's start with the elephant in the plexus, the sciatic nerve. The first thing you notice is its size, and how it seems like it's a mashup of all these spinal roots together. But in reality, the sciatic nerve is made from contributions from L4, L5, S1, S2, and S3. It doesn't get contribution from S4. The sciatic nerve passes through the greater sciatic foramen inferior to the piriformis muscle, like you can see in this picture. Then it travels inferiorly along the back of the leg, branching off to innervate the hamstring muscles and some of the adductor magnus. Then, when it gets to the knee, it splits off into the tibial nerve, which innervates most of the posterior leg and foot, and common fibular nerve, which innervates the anterior and lateral portion of the leg. You might also hear the common fibular nerve called the common peroneal nerve. They're the same thing. I made this analogy before, but you can think of this like cable management. You have multiple cables starting at an outlet, then you wrap them up before they split again. It's the same thing with the sciatic nerve. It starts as the union of these spinal roots, stays together, then splits when it gets to the knee. When you come back to the sacral plexus, though, you see how the sciatic nerve, this one thick nerve, is made up by two divisions of the sacral plexus. The branches that feed into the tibial nerve are more anterior, while the branches that feed into the common fibular nerve are more posterolateral. Also, the common fibular division is made from spinal roots L4 through S2, while the tibial division is made from spinal roots L4 through S3, so it's a little bit of a different input. Moving on, I'm going to split the terminal nerves of the sacral plexus into smaller groups based on directional terms to make them more manageable to learn. Starting on the posterior side, you've got six separate branches in two main locations. The first section includes the superior gluteal nerve, the inferior gluteal nerve, and the nerve to the piriformis. Meanwhile, the second posterior group includes the posterior femoral cutaneous nerve, the perforating cutaneous nerve, and the pelvic splanchnic nerve. First up, the superior gluteal nerve, which is made from the spinal nerves off of L4, L5, and S1. After they merge, the nerve pokes through the sciatic foramen too, but unlike the sciatic nerve, it exits superior to the piriformis muscle. Then it branches out to innervate three muscles, the gluteus medius, gluteus minimus, and TFL, or tensor fascia lata. If you remember your muscle origins, then this nerve falls exactly where you'd expect. The superior gluteal region is this general area of the pelvis, which is where the glute min and glute med originate, while the TFL originates more anteriorly, on the anterior iliac crest and anterior superior iliac spine, that bony bump on the front of your hip. The big gluteal exception is the gluteus maximus, which is not innervated by this nerve. That's because it's innervated by the next branch of the sacral plexus, the inferior gluteal nerve. This one is made from spinal nerves L5, S1, and S2. Just like the others, it exits the sciatic foramen, then passes inferior to the piriformis, obviously making for a visible distinction between the superior and inferior gluteal nerves. From there, it branches out further to innervate the gluteus maximus. The final terminal nerve in this area is the nerve to the piriformis. Nice and easy, it only innervates one muscle and it's near the muscle it innervates. It's made from spinal nerves S1 and S2. Since I'm chunking all of these together, it's probably a good time for a mnemonic. I use SIPCP, which I remember as Sip Chardonnay and Prosecco because I'm a fancy wine tasting boy now. But for all of you minors, maybe use Sip Coke and Pepsi. The superior gluteal, inferior gluteal, and nerve to piriformis plug into the common peroneal. The next posterior chunk includes everything that dangles down here. It's easy to get these mixed up with the other nerves, so look closely in your diagram to see if they're drawn behind other nerves. That's a good hint about whether they'll be in the anterior or posterior group. This chunk includes the posterior femoral cutaneous nerve, the perforating cutaneous nerve, and the pelvic splanchnic nerve. The posterior cutaneous nerve of the thigh, or posterior femoral cutaneous nerve, same thing, is made from both anterior and posterior divisions of spinal nerves. In particular, the posterior divisions of S1 and S2 and the anterior divisions of S2 and S3. Luckily, that's the hardest thing about learning it. It follows the same path as the sciatic nerve, and the name tells you exactly what it does. Cutaneous just means skin, so this nerve innervates the skin of the posterior thigh. We saw the anterior, intermediate, and lateral femoral cutaneous nerves back in the lumbar plexus video. The next one, the perforating cutaneous nerve, has a simpler origin made up of only posterior divisions, this time from S2 and S3. It gets its name from the fact that it perforates a broad ligament called the sacrotuberous ligament. But another heads up, it's absent in up to one-third of people, and sometimes it branches off of the pudendal nerve. It's another cutaneous nerve, and it innervates the skin around the inferior medial buttocks. This last one, the pelvic splanchnic nerve, is kind of an odd one out. You'll notice how I don't have an image of it on the plexus. Well, that's because it's part of the autonomic nervous system. I'm teaching it with the sacral plexus since it shares its origin with other sacral spinal nerves, S2, S3, and S4. This nerve handles parasympathetic nervous signals for anatomy like the bladder, parts of the colon, urethra, genitals, and more. Fun fact though, the branches of the pelvic splanchnic are what allow for the physical changes seen during sexual arousal. Nice. Those are all of the posterior structures of the sacral plexus. So now it's time to tackle the anterior structures, which includes the nerve to the quadratus femoris, the nerve to the obturator internus, the pudendal nerve, and the nerve to the levator ani muscles. The nerve to quadratus femoris branches off of the anterior divisions of L4, L5, and S1. Like all these guys, it passes through the sciatic foramen and plugs into its muscle. Obviously, it innervates the quadratus femoris, this square-shaped muscle that originates on the ischium and inserts on the femur, but it also innervates the inferior gemellus muscle, which is right above it. That one seems like an easy trick question on a multiple-choice exam. Next up is the nerve to the obturator internus, which branches off of spinal nerves L5, S1, and S2. Surprise, surprise, it goes through the sciatic foramen to innervate the obturator internus muscle and the superior gemellus muscle. Next, the pudendal nerve, which is made from the anterior divisions of S2, S3, and S4. I find this nerve super interesting. It travels inferiorly through the sciatic foramen, but then it hooks medially to innervate the skin and muscles of the perineum. But what's fascinating about this nerve is its etymology. Pudendal comes from the Latin word for genitals, which makes sense, but the word also translates to shame. These days, hopefully we don't see any piece of anatomy as shameful, but it's an interesting glimpse into medical history. And as a super quick plug, I have a separate channel all about the history of medicine, which you can find here. The pudendal nerve does divide even further, though. One of its branches is the perineal nerve, which innervates the structures in the perineum, which you can see on this inferior to superior view. The pudendal nerve also splits into the inferior rectal nerve, which innervates the external anal sphincter, and the dorsal nerve of the penis and clitoris, which allow for sensory nervous signals. So the next time things are getting spicy, just spare a moment for your pudendal nerve. The next one is the nerve to the levator ani, which branches from spinal nerves S3 and S4. Based on its position, it's going straight down. No need to pass through the sciatic foramen. It innervates the levator ani, which is a group of three muscles that make the majority of the pelvic floor. It also innervates the coccygeus muscle, which is posterior to the levator ani. But this nerve's got some variation too. Some sources will identify the nerve as its own thing, while some say that the levator ani group is innervated by parts of the coccygeal plexus. The final nerve in this diagram is the perineal branch of S4. It's such a tiny little nerve and innervates the skin around the anus, and sometimes it innervates the external anal sphincter. Honestly, there's a chance it won't even be drawn on your diagram for class. Now that we've met all of our players on the plexus, let me show you how I'd fill out the sacral plexus diagram. Like with all the other plexuses, start by identifying the bony landmarks, which are the fifth lumbar vertebrae and the sacrum. Then label the four sacral foramina and corresponding spinal nerves, L4, L5, S1, S2, S3, and S4. Remember, there is an S5 nerve, but it doesn't play with the sacral plexus. In the next step, I take different sections and give them mnemonics. I already gave you sip Chardonnay and Prosecco to remember that the superior gluteal, inferior gluteal, and the nerve to the piriformis all become the common peroneal. So next, you'll identify the second posterior chunk, the tibial portion of the sciatic nerve, then the posterior femoral cutaneous, perforating cutaneous, and if you have it on your diagram, the pelvic splanchnic. These are in a crowded neighborhood, so make sure you're labeling posterior structures by checking that they're drawn behind something else, not in front of it. Once you've done that, I find that I actually don't need a mnemonic for this one. The tibial portion of the sciatic nerve is such a good mental anchor, and the posterior femoral cutaneous is noticeably thicker, which makes me think it's going to follow the sciatic down the leg. Then the perforating cutaneous sticks in my mind because it's such a unique name. Finally, we move on to the anterior structures. Like before, double check that they're drawn in front of the posterior structures. Then, from lateral to medial, we've got the nerve to the quadratus femoris, nerve to the obturator internus, pudendal nerve, and nerve to the levator ani. Put them together and it's QOPL. And since so many of these plug into the anus or genitals, a fitting memory device is quickly or poop later. Look, I know it's a stretch, but it's what works for me. If you've got a good mnemonic, drop it in the comments. Either way, now we have a fully labeled sacral plexus. Before you go, all those beautiful illustrations you saw in this video were kindly provided by KenHub. And if you want to learn more about the sacral plexus or any other anatomy topic, you need to check them out. KenHub is an anatomy learning platform that I use all the time when writing and fact-checking these videos. They've got an enormous library of in-depth videos and articles about gross anatomy, histology, blood vessels, and everything else you'd learn in anatomy class. All the beautiful illustrations you saw in this video came from KenHub's Atlas, which often comes with multiple angles and illustrations of each structure, as well as cadaver images and cross sections. In addition to their library of content, I love KenHub's quiz feature. They allow you to take different types of quizzes with varying difficulties, and they'll give you personalized feedback so you can figure out your weaknesses and quiz on just that material. You can also create your own custom quiz by selecting the structures and topics that you want to be quizzed on. You can use most of KenHub's features for free, but if you want full access to all of their content and quizzes, and there is a lot of them, you can go to khub.me/corporis for 10% off your subscription. They've also got a no questions asked 7-day money back guarantee, so you can try out the premium version for 7 days, and if you don't like it for whatever reason, then you can get your money back. Thank you, KenHub, for sponsoring this series. This was the final video in the Plexus series. If you want to see the rest of the playlist, you can check it out right here. I've also got a basics of the nervous system video right here. I got my crowdfunding Patreon link right there and my subscribe button right there. Thank you, patrons. Have fun. Be good. Thanks for watching.